Today is Monday, January 25th, and my name is Brandon Springer. I'm interviewing Mary Hay, who is formerly the president of the Soviet Sister City Project. The interview is being recorded for the Maria Rogers Oral History Program and is being filmed by Emily Schuster. So Mary, my first question is when and where you were born?
I was born February 19th, 1949 in Minneapolis, Minnesota.
And did you grow up in Minneapolis?
I did. In the suburb thereof. Yeah, and I initially came to Boulder as a student when I was 18. So that was in 1967.
And you went to CU Boulder?
I did.
Excellent. And how was that?
It was fine.
That's fine.
I was in and out of school a lot. There were turbulent times. The university was shut down during the late 60s mm-hmm. and so forth. And so I did drop out of school a few times. I had a semester, a year abroad, and so forth. So, CU was lovely.
And where abroad did you go?
I lived in Japan for a year, and then after that traveled around the world to come home. I just kept going west.
And then, so it was the 60s. Were you involved in any sort of activism or?
In the 60s, I was not an activist. I was more on a religious quest. Mm-hmm. I was there. I was aware of obviously, of the war in Vietnam and all the turmoil, and friends of mine were drafted and so forth. But I wasn't a political person. It wasn't where my energy was. Although I participated in candlelight vigils and things like that.
Mm-hmm. And you said there were turbulent times at CU. What did you make of those turbulent times?
I was just a young, rather wild person, and it was around us everywhere. It was in the newspapers, and there were massive rallies, and people were getting tear gassed and so forth. So I was clearly opposed to the war. I just really didn't have a political instinct. I picked that up later, actually, coming home from Japan. And I picked it up with a vengeance when I picked it up.
Yeah. And so when did you end up getting your degree? And what did you get your degree in?
I ended up getting my degree in 1975. It was in East Asian Studies. That was the degree I got. And then later I went back to school, so I have another degree. I have a law degree from the university as well.
From CU?
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
And then, so after you got your law degree, what did you end up doing?
Well, initially, immediately after, you skipped a bunch of years here, so.
We can go back if you like.
No, that's all right. That's fine. After the law degree, and I went to law school really thinking I had done lobbying in Washington for a group, a Quaker group. I'm a member of the Society of Friends, and through lobbying for various, I did that for many years, 18 years, and I thought that a law degree would be a good thing for me to have, and that there'd be some. So in really, I went when I was 40 to law school, and it really wasn't the best decision I ever made. It didn't really match my talents, and so I did clerk for a Boulder District Court judge for 1 year right after law school, which was wonderful. It was the best job I ever had. Wonderful mix of intellectual rigor and soap opera, which was really terrific. And then I did practice for several years after that, doing some, and I worked in a rather unusual way because I didn't work for a firm. I worked with other lawyers and in a kind of catch-as-catch-can way. People seemed to want me to be their lawyer, but really I was not skilled enough, so I would have other lawyers come in on cases and so forth. So it was kind of a rather bizarre way to practice law. And I then went to the, ended up at the Native American Rights Fund, and that was the end of my really practicing law.
So in between getting your undergraduate degree and getting your law degree, what was going on in your life?
You know, it's such a huge question because it's a huge number of years, so mm-hmm. it's hard to, I guess it would be a little easier to, I mean, since this is about my life as an activist is probably the thing that's most interesting, maybe I could just describe that.
Sure.
As I said, when I returned to the United States, I traveled back from Japan in, took me several months to get back, and I left Japan with $300 and was living and sleeping in train stations and living. It was a very wild experience partly through Central Asia. I mean, went through Thailand and then up through India. At the time, my brother, who had been living in Iran, had, from my mother's point of view anyway, disappeared, and so she told me to go look for him. I had a little picture of him in my wallet. And went to Nepal, where he was in a monastery at some point, and there I found out that he had gone on to Athens. So it wasn't as romantic as I had hoped it would be, that I would get to pull out the, I did think we get to pull it out in Nepal, where they did go, David! So, and then I traveled. So I traveled through India and Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran, Turkey, across to Greece, where I did find him. Hmm. And on that trip, and particularly the trip through Afghanistan, across that that sort of Silk Road kind of area, which I think it's probably still somewhat true, there was really one road. I mean, it was not. There was a way that people had gone for hundreds of years. I was thrown together with Europeans who were very political, they wanted to know my opinions. I felt very uncomfortable because I really didn't have very many political opinions. And we arrived in Athens. I looked out in Piraeus Harbor, and there was the Sixth Fleet was parked there. And it's kind of embarrassing to say, but it was one of the, it was a very strong political thought. Like, what is the Sixth Fleet doing here? Why are we here? Which is a question I should have asked many years prior to this, but I hadn't. And then it just, from that initial thought, a whole bunch of things came after that. When I got back to the United States, I had a friend who was very, very political in town here, named Judy Hurley. She was quite a character and a figure here during that time. This would have been the early 70s. She was very excited about demonstrating at Rocky Flats. So this would have been 1974. She talked me into, you know, getting excited about this, and I went to a Rocky Flats demonstration in 74 that I believe was one of the very first. There were like 10 of us there. We had a little shovel. We were going to bury the nuclear age. And so that that just got me asking more and more questions. I then moved to California, and I did worked with a group called the Pacific Life Community, which was... And I was learning all along about nuclear weapons and getting more and more upset about this stuff. And the Pacific Life Community was dedicated to stopping the Trident submarine. And we protested at Lockheed and other places, I don't recall now, and got involved then with other people in the Pacific Life Community it was a group in Bremerton, Washington, that a radical Catholic guy had organized a tracking of trains carrying the weapons from the Pantex plant in Texas up to Washington, where they were put on the boats. And so I was around a lot of radical people, really, who were, and mostly, almost exclusively, it was around the issue of disarmament, nuclear disarmament. So after doing that, I came back to Boulder, and when my daughter was born, I worked for a group called the Mobilization for Survival, and when my daughter was born, which I guess was before I got involved with the mobilization, it just set me on fire. She was obviously totally dependent on me, and you know, that this whole idea of the nuclear arms race, that she had nothing to do with it and had no way to protect herself, and I don't know, it's some mother thing, which is quite fierce, this protecting of your child. And so the I got really became a zealot for nuclear disarmament. And so after working with the Boulder Mobilization for a couple of years, I became the leader of the group. So this is, would be 77, 78, 79, I guess in there. And we did, you know, really focused on Rocky Flats, because nobody knew what the plant was. I mean, it was really interesting. We did a survey, we'd walk around door to door, people didn't even know what it was. It was so far in the, you know, it's like looking through the binoculars from the wrong end. It was just like so far away.
Yeah.
So we did that work, and in 1982, the Friends meeting, the Quaker meeting, had made a decision to hire someone to work full-time for peace and become a peace secretary for the, that's just a term of art, Quakers, for the meeting. And the idea was that the person would work below a taxable level, and which was $10,000 at the time, and then would just work for peace and create opportunities for people to do peace witness, peace testimony. We have a strong peace testimony in the Quakers. So I was hired as the peace secretary, and one of the first things that we did, and this is prior to the Sister City Project, is that a member of our meeting, Gilbert White, he's the guy who, the flood guy, you know, there's a monument down by the creek.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was considered the father of floodplain management. And he was a member of the Soviet Academy of Sciences.
Oh.
And as some others were in Boulder, because regardless of the Cold War, the scientists continued to meet.
Mm-hmm.
Really a wonderful thing about science that has been true in lots of time periods. And he and his wife had traveled to the Soviet Union many times. In 1982, virtually no one had been there. I mean, really, it was extraordinarily rare to meet someone who had been there. And even rarer to have a Russian be here, to meet a Russian. I had never met one. And hardly anyone I knew had. So in developing the program for this was a novel program in the meeting to hire somebody, and we decided on a project, and one of the things that was of interest was this idea of the Russians. Gilbert did a lot of work on nuclear winter, which I don't know if you know about that. That's the idea that a certain number of explosions or nuclear war would have a catastrophic effect on the environment. It would create a kind of winter situation by throwing so much junk into the atmosphere that the sun would be blocked and so forth.
Mm.
So we operate by a kind of consensus. I mean, we agree on what should happen. So anyway, this idea about the Russians kept coming up, and so it's when you're having this was in a sense a novel thought, really,
mm.
And when you're having novel thoughts, it's always, there's nothing to hang them on. It's exciting and kind of chaotic. And so we had lists of things. Actually, I pulled this out because it was so, I hope I did. This is, it was here, Understanding the People of the Soviet Union. So this is, in 1982. And so we made this list, the friends did, you know, we have to educate ourselves, identify specific fears people have about the USSR, humanize the Soviet people in our eyes, promote more rational understanding between the people of the US, the people of the USSR, you know, and so forth. And we were just casting wildly, trying to figure out anything we could do to accomplish that. Mm-hmm. And you want me to just keep talking?
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
Please.
And simultaneously, I was had a, you know, a public persona. I was debating. I was in public debates and had some kind of little presence in this little pond, and would argue about the arms race. I knew tons of stuff about weapons. I mean, I blessedly have forgotten it, along with lots of other things, but that I used to know, like how many weapons there were and the throw weights and the circular error probable if you dropped one and the different, you know, the Pershings and the SS-20s. And I mean, I just had, and the waste issues, I had tons of information. So I talked to people about this. And what I noticed was that when you talked about, you know, I was trying to persuade people. I was pretty persuasive, I think, of the complete futility of these weapons. That it would come to a certain point, and the people would say, "Well, you know, but you're here. It's easy for you to say. You know, what about the Russians?" And it was a kind of a conversation stopper. That then there was nothing to say, and it was extremely frustrating. But I noticed it, that that's the way it worked. Actually, my father used to do the same thing to me. We'd be arguing about something, and then he'd bring God into it. And the next thing I knew, there was nothing to say. It was like, I didn't like this sort of game over with the Russians. Mm-hmm. And then it must have been also in 1982. This was a complete happenstance. I was at a meeting for the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, which was a group in town. I think it still exists. And I met a woman, and we just started to talk. I'd never met her before. And she and I had come to the same place. And so we were so excited to talk to each other. Because I said, you know, what's that? So I say this stuff, and she said, yeah, that's what I hear too. And so the friends meeting had already thought about the idea of a sister city, although it wasn't even a rational idea because there was no ability to get such a thing. But it was just one of these brainstorming ideas. And Sophia had thought of it too. She had relatives from Ukraine, and so she had a connection, a Slavic kind of connection and so forth. So that encounter was really, I think, the first time that two people in this town seriously thought this. So the two of us began to meet.
And sorry, but mm-hmm. who was that you were meeting with?
Sophia Stoller.
Sophia Stoller.
Yeah, and she might be someone you'd like to interview because she has a different perspective on it. I mean, she and I worked hand in hand for the first years of the project. Mm-hmm. So we got this idea and started to think of it. And I haven't, you know, I came across the first article, but that's, we'd already were going to the newspaper, so I'm not sure. Let me see if I can. Yeah,
don't
so.
Put it up here.
It's okay. So this is from the Daily Camera. That's August of 83. This is after that. I know the first meeting we had with city officials or with a group of interested people was February 3rd, 1983. So, and there was, obviously there must have been preparatory work, and if I looked through these files and really systematically organized them, I could probably figure all this stuff out. But do you want me to put something white behind there so that it's...
Sure.
I think that would help it so it doesn't look... Here, I'll stick here. It's probably a little... Oops. It's going to work. Yeah, so we had then the initial meeting, and we had a small group of people who had an interest. Someone from the Slavic Studies Department, I know Linda Jorgensen, who was a council member at the time, was at that first group where we were just trying to feel out if this could even happen. Mm-hmm. So.
And what year was that?
1983.
That was 1983, okay. Yeah. And so what came of that meeting?
Well, that was just that was an initiating thing. And then through this group of people, we just started to meet and talk. And I hope you don't mind if I look at these notes.
Of course not.
Because I really just found, I haven't seen this stuff since 1983. I don't believe I've looked at some of this. But yeah, so these are steering committee meetings and so forth, all in 83. And I don't know when we named ourselves the Sister City Project, but anyway, that is the first. In the group of people, there were six. In one of these articles, it says there were six people who started it. So the organizers include Mary Hay, Doris Havas, professor emeritus at the University of Colorado. She was a very feisty old woman, extremely opinionated, wonderful. Mary Axe, who is the person who really brought the tea house and has carried this thing for, it takes hundreds of people to do this stuff, but she's been the leader for the past decade or so. Anne White, who was Gilbert White's wife, Nicholas Lee, chairman of the Slavic Languages and Literatures Department. But there were others too, I know, at that very beginning.
Did you
put this down now?
Okay. It seems that it was mostly women who were mobilizing this effort. Did you want to speak to that, perhaps?
Well, I don't know that it's any more than women being more relational. I mean, and that this is about relations. It's about people. The Sister Cities International, which was started in 1956 by Eisenhower, slogan is people to people, or world peace through people to people understanding. And so I think it's that. I mean, a lot of people in the peace movement also, I mean, the kind of protective quality of women too, and this protection of children. I mean, I think it's, there were a lot of women who did this work. Mm-hmm. But there were men also who played really important roles. I don't mean to, but yeah, it was definitely mostly women.
So after the meeting in 1983, what was the next step towards mobilizing the Soviet Sister City group in Boulder?
Well, it wasn't like a next step. I mean, that's a little artificial, because we were just like mucking around. We were grasping at anything we could think of. Anything that had to do with Russia, we started to pay attention to. And many of us, Not all of us were motivated by peace concerns, but we were extremely aware that we couldn't do this as a political, and it wasn't that we were dishonestly trying to pretend we weren't political, but we steered the group, because Sister Cities International is explicitly non-political. I mean, that's the whole idea, is you drop the politics and you have other kinds of relationships, and you don't act like the politics are the only thing we have in common. So we started to have, you know, we just, you know, it was like a, just a wild small group, because we were just making it up. And really this was true for those years. We made it up as we went along. And we took advantage of opportunities that arose. And anybody who'd been to the Soviet Union, we would have them come and talk to us. And we started to have programs, because the educational element was such a big deal. I mean, that's what we were really interested in people not having an unbelievably one-dimensional reaction when they heard the words Soviet Union. I mean, it was like maybe 1.5 dimensions. It was so limited. People had very strong opinions and were hot on the topic. Mm-hmm. But it really had to do, it was a very narrow range about freedom of information, about dissidents, about you know, lies, and you know, it was just like this kind of, and people would tense up. It was pretty, you know, once I started to do the work, I really paid attention to how people were around the topic, and they all kind of like riled up. So we had these programs, and we decided that what we needed to do was have programs that were absolutely benign. So the first program we had, I don't remember the very first one, which I am sure is in here somewhere, because 100 people showed. We put up some flyers and did some stuff, and we thought, you know, we'd had a lot of political experience organizing meetings and trying to get people to think about stuff. You know, you'd get 20 people, that was a good bunch. And it turned out that 100 people showed up for this event. We made a decision early on that we were always going to serve food, and we had Russian food. So we'd have, I made hundreds of poppy seed cakes. And because we thought people were nicer when they ate, you know, and it had some other feel to it than this kind of being at loggerheads. So I remember standing, this is the very first program, and we were all, keyed up. And I'm standing behind, and we must have had a panel of people saying stuff, but they were not saying anything inflammatory at all. And the audience at the back, there were guys from the ROTC, it was an amazing range of people. And somebody would say something, and half of the group would go, And I thought, wow, this is actually working. Because this is what we wanted. We didn't want people who were ideologically committed in any direction, really. We wanted people to actually open themselves up and admit their ignorance, which we were doing, and having a great deal of fun realizing how completely stupid we were on the topic. I mean, so we started to have these programs, and we had then lots and lots of programs, which I can show you some of them. I came across a little, I'm sorry, but I'm just a slightly not on top of these papers. Yeah, there was, we brought in like mountain climbers who had climbed, there's some peaks like in Pakistan that are very near Dushanbe, and I guess Dushanbe wasn't on the table then, but anyway, people who had climbed to peak communism, and plants. I mean, this is the kind, we went to the things that we thought, we wanted the things that people could not get ticked off about. Mm-hmm. Because they, and so, like we showed the movie Nicholas and Alexandra, which the worst reaction we got was a guy who said, "This is the worst movie, why did you play this movie?" But, so in this, that was the very, very beginning, and we functioned doing that because we didn't have a sister city, of course, and we, in the background then, we were working fervidly to try to figure out how to do this. The way things were set up then, the Sister Cities International recognized 6 pairings with the Soviet Union. 5 were set up by Brezhnev and Nixon in 19, I don't know what the year is now. It's in the early 70s. And I'm not sure, actually. and those were established by fiat. So you had the 5 cities were just given sister cities by officials. Mm-hmm. You know, the State Department and the Kremlin agreed. And of those 5, only 1 was really functioning, which was Seattle-Tashkent. Because they were established from the top down, you know, then you don't have people really interested, and so it takes something to keep these things going. So the so that was the only model, except for then Detroit got one. Detroit and Minsk made a pairing based on some labor movement kind of thing. So they got some kind of labor interests going. And so that was the only one that had been formed, but it also had a certain top-down kind of quality to it. So there were these 6, and that was it. And there was no model for how you actually went to get one. So we started to just use every bit of our imagination and to try to figure out how to do this, which was, I can't tell you, this was maybe one of the very most fun parts of my life. I really had a good time doing this.
Yeah.
So we began, I was going to Washington often for other reasons, and so we started to make, write letters, and we never got answers to these letters. So we're writing, you know, letters to the embassy, writing to whoever, you know, writing to this, talking to the State Department, asking them to help, and how do you do this, and so forth. So this went on for years of making these forays through official channels, which is the only way. I mean, the way things were structured then, of course, the Soviet citizens had no power to do anything. This had to be officially sanctioned. So from there, at the same time, there were scientists traveling, and they were the only ones who had been to the Soviet Union. Some people had gone on, they had these little socialist tours and stuff, like a lot of people who were hot, you know, a little bit influenced in the 1930s by the communism and stuff, and who were, they would take boat rides down the Volga and stuff and come back and talk about them, but basically there was not, except for the scientists. And so there were a couple of scientists. One was a guy named Joe Allen and another named Jim Scott. And Jim Scott was a physicist. Joe Allen, I don't recall exactly what he did. But they would, so we would ask them, tell us, you know, what cities, you know, how do we do this? And the official path was going nowhere. And at some point, Gainesville, Florida, decided they just were going to do this. So they made a contact. It wasn't with Novosibirsk or Novorodny or some, I don't remember the city, but they decided they were just going to talk to the, they just made a foray, and they got some communication going with a city. So we thought, okay, we'll just choose a city. And as we continued to press the officials, so we started thinking about different cities. The first one we thought of, which I don't know which scientist told us that this would be a good city, it's called Akadiem Gorodok, which means university town in Russian. And we thought, well, this sounds great. And somebody said, oh yeah, they have bike paths and they have, you know, like a lot of scientists. And so we thought, okay, this is great. So we started to write then about Akadiem Gorodok. Simultaneously, I started to go to the embassy. You could go, there was a guy named Sergei Romanov, and I'd call up. It was so funny. When you called the Soviet embassy, which I really can't emphasize enough to you how intensely chilled this climate was. You know, how this was really, you know, the very idea. I know that my phone was, you know, as soon as I made a call to the embassy, you know, I have an FBI file that it was generated surely in part by this activity. That going, you know, so I'd call the embassy and the voice wouldn't even say Soviet embassy. It would say, hello. It's like, hello. And when I first, the first foray I made to the embassy, I'm carrying, I mean, in these papers, I got letters from the mayor saying I'm a real genuine representative of the city. And so in the interim, we're trying to convince the officials here to give us a, you know, trust us that we're going to do something okay. And Mayor Carell was, Ruth Carell, who was a wonderful mayor, really helped that. And we're doing other things, getting letters from the Chamber of Commerce and like tea bags to take to them and like little stuff trying to indicate wide representation or, you know, that some kind of bolster our what we had. But the first time I go to see Sergei Romanov, I have a file of clippings from our little, we started to also have these spring festivals in addition to, yeah, so these Russian festivals. I have to talk about this all at once because it really was all happening at the same time. Yeah, so this would be, here's a Russian spring festival. I honestly don't know which year that is. But these things where we'd have Ukrainian egg dyeing here, it talks Russian folk music, klezmer music. We had people dancing and dyeing these eggs, slideshows and stuff. And we would serve food. Food was always a huge part of this deal.
Mm-hmm.
And at one of these spring festivals, I just came across, I was looking through, maybe it said that we had 700 people show up. We had one at Boulder High. Yeah, and the lists of people, like these are the people we had to thank after the festival. There are so many names. We had huge lists of people who were contributing and companies that were giving things. So this was all, here's the third annual, here's another one. This one was a Boulder High, I guess that's, yeah.
And you said you had klezmer music.
Yeah, just anybody who had anything that was in any way connected. Yeah, there was a group called Klezmer Vod who would come and play at these. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so here's an article, Russian food. We really hit the food hard. I figure it's hard for people to argue if they really are eating great stuff. Mm-hmm. So I had these sorts of examples for Sergei Romanov. And Boulder had I had a whole little sheaf of them. The first time I went into the embassy, there's a guard outside, and it was it's the old Pullman mansion, in D.C. And it's got a wrought iron fence outside, a guy with a gun, you know, like a machine gun kind of standing outside. And you go and you press the button, you know, it's like a little security system. And again, the guy just said, well, first the sort of said, what do you want? I said, you know, I have an appointment with Sergei Romanov, you know, my name is, and then so I went through then it's a series of security fences before you get in the door. When you get in the door, it's obviously been made in this strange way where there's a bulletproof glass and there's a guy sitting with the glass over there. There's a Xerox machine here. And then to the left, there's another room. And everything is mirrors. Everything but the glass is mirrors. So when you're in there, you know, they're like, and they're little mirror, you know, they're like, it's not all mirror, it's like, so there are like a zillion of you there. Yeah. And so I went in to talk to Sergei Romanov, and he was, had his, you know, the Russians had this fantastic way, and I guess, I don't know if it was Soviet or, I think it's probably still true, of looking like completely bored by anything you said. And they'd cross their legs, you know, and just be like, you know, we already know all this and that. So I'm talking to him about that, about the sister city, and saying, we want to try this. And I'm leafing through the things, and I said, yeah, we have the letter from the mayor, and I have the letter from, here's a restaurateur, you know, who's interested in, and then I said, and then here's about the Boulder Balalaika band. And he had been completely not interested. He looked at me and said, there's a Balalaika band in Boulder? I said, yeah, there is, actually. And I showed him the article. And from then, he started to get interested, started to ask me questions. So, who are you? And who are these people? And so forth. So he said he would try to do something. He said, but we won't do any city under 100,000. That's the rule. You know, it's in the, there was a group for the Association for Understanding Between People, you know, USSR and US or something, that he said that's only nothing smaller than that. So I made another trip with more gigas to give him, and then at some point in there, and I can't say exactly what year, we got a little notice that said, you know, only cities of 100,000, and then in the parentheses it said, or maybe 80,000. And we looked at it, we thought, because that was, Boulder was 85, I think, at the time. And so it was like, is that us? and so as we're going forward, so the Akadem Gorodok thing, I mentioned to him, he says, this, we found out it was a closed city, that there were no hotels, and you know, everything. And to travel in the Soviet Union, you had to go through Intourist. You had to be with a Soviet guide who was a party member all the time. You know, that was very controlled. So then Joe, I think it was Joe Allen who said, well, or maybe it was Jim Scott, said, Dushanbe is a, you know, and his wife, he was married to a Russian who he had brought here. And he had spent time in Dushanbe. And so he said, I think this is a good one. He said, it's just like Boulder. He said, you know, it's the weather, it's on the 40th parallel, it's dry, there are mountains, and it's like, so we knew nothing. We said, okay, Dushanbe it is. So So we went with that, and I'll just tell you what we found out later about Akademi Gorodok is it not only was a closed city, it was the center for biological weapons.
Oh, wow.
A center. And so they must have freaked them out when we named this. It was not a very big place. Mm-hmm. When we selected that, it was a completely secret place. So it was like... so the Dushanbe thing, so we're just going along, and then the scientists, we started to have people carry letters who were going to Dushanbe and try to meet with the mayor. And there were several aborted. Once a guy went and they to see the mayor, and they said, the mayor is on a boondoggle. I know. Away. You can't meet him. And finally, Joe handed him a letter. And this has been going on now, at that point, for a few years, probably. And the mayor said, you people in Boulder are very persistent. So there was just a little something, but we still had no idea of there being a possibility of really breaking through this deal. Because, again, there's just the six cities, right? And this is like novel material. So then I made another trip to the embassy and met Romanov again, and then finally got an invitation from this guy, Andrei Pestov, who was the first secretary of the Soviet embassy. So this is the big job. And I went, and now it was feeling like it was like old hat, right? I go up, there's the guard with the gun, you know, that I go up, and I went to push the button for this third one, and the security thing just clicked open. And then I went in, you know, I went through, and there were two more gates, as I recall. And then as I walked toward them, they just clicked open. I'm telling you, this was psychologically very unnerving. There was something about it. And then I walked in, and the two times I'd been there before, there'd been the person behind the glass, and now there's nobody there. So I'm standing in this initial anteroom. The other room was, the door was closed. And there's the door to the main building, which is this mansion. And I'm just standing there with all these mirrors and knowing that they're almost certainly watching me. And they let me cool my heels there for probably 5 minutes, which is a long time if you're standing thinking people that you can't see are watching you and not knowing what to do. I mean, I thought, is it wrong for me to like try to open the door? And at some point I moved toward there was a handle and a door, and they opened the door and all these guys were in there laughing. and I walked in, and there were guys, uniformed guys with guns, you know, lined up, and then I was led into the embassy, which was just absolutely gorgeous. It was really beautiful, you know, up this carpeted huge stairway and met with this kind of gnomish Mr. Pestov. He was not a charming character, and I think they were just trying to get a look at me, because, you know, they couldn't understand who I was, what I was. So after that, then we did start to, I can't remember what we got, some idea that this is really going to go forward. So in 86, I took a trip there. And that this was the idea, and, you know, I can't remember quite how we... By then we knew the name of the mayor of Dushanbe, his name was Shorokmanov, and the trip was a UN trip, but it was just a tourist trip. But five people from Boulder went, a couple that really was hardly involved with the Sister City Project, and then Sam Sussman, who owns 8 days a week, he and his wife went, and myself. And I had a whole suitcase full of things, little tchotchkes to, you know, entertain them and show our goodwill. And all these letters, you know, had, like, you know, and they're really into seals and like officialdom and stuff. So the trip was actually all the way through Central Asia and through Kazakhstan and all the stands. And we've got to Dushanbe, and these Aeroflot planes, they're terrifying. They would land. They're all military pilots, or they were, and they would land. They don't take off and land the way we do. They just take off like this, and then they land. You know, where you're coming down, you think like, whoa, maybe you'd like to pull it up a little bit here. So as we're, the whole group then got interested in Boulder's enterprise here, and they, I'm telling people, either we have a sister city or we don't, and we'll know as soon as we get to the airport, because, you know, there's going to be a little, you know, little greeting committee if we do, and if there's no fuss about us arriving, then we don't. So we get there, and we got off the plane, and not only is there no reception, the guide did, failed to show up. So we were there without even like knowing where we're supposed to be going. We just had the guide who was our guide for the 3 weeks. So I was totally glum. I mean, I carried this stuff, you know, halfway around the world, and here I am. And so we got to the hotel, and I'm leaning on, I could just feel the kind of like, ugh, you know, came all this way, and leaning on the counter, and there was this, the young man who was the guide, he came over, and I said, I'm from Boulder, and he said, what is your name? I said, my name is Mary Hay. He said, I read about you. I said, you read about me where? He said, in the paper. So I thought, okay. Yeah, so then we had this, it was just an extraordinary experience for me, that of being treated like, it's my only experience of my life where I think I understand what royalty feels like, that I would, they only called me with honorifics, they only called me the amiable Mary Hay, the honorable Mary Hay. They couldn't say my name without attaching some. And I got used to it. I thought, like, this is kind of great. And then we had a banquet with more silverware than I had ever seen. I mean, it was completely ludicrous. It's like some kind of comedy, actually, that there was, and I thought, God, I hope I know how to do this. And I'm in all these glasses, and we're standing around schmoozing with, and these are the government officials, the city council, and the mayor and stuff. And finally, the deputy mayor comes up and says, you must sit down now. And I said, oh, okay, well, she said, because no one knows where to sit until you sit down. So I sat down, and then they all jockeyed to see how, because everything's hierarchical, you know, it's a very bureaucratic deal. So they all jockeyed around to see who got the closest to me to prove their merit. Yeah, and then we drank a ton of vodka, and it was one of these deals to be... especially in a Central Asian culture, you know, you can't refuse. So, so we just ate and drank. And then they took us all around town. I'm sure I have a picture of this. Like, I'm sorry, I'm not more organized with this.
Oh, you're fine.
The show and tell stuff. So, yeah, I don't know here. This is after we got back, but there's a picture of us walking down. Let me see if I can find an actual photograph here. Have to get into 86 here. Yeah, it's just simply not organized, and that's the truth of it. Did you graduate in history?
No, political science and journalism.
Of which?
Political science and journalism.
Uh-huh. See, I was going to offer you the great opportunity to go through and organize all my papers. simply not happening. This is the article that I showed to the guy at the Soviet embassy about the Balalaika group, which is probably the central reason we got the sister city. I think if I hadn't gotten past Sergei Romanov, but I don't think this would have happened.
So then you were telling us about the trip.
Yeah, so then we came back, and then after the trip, then all this, then I really should maybe just pull these articles, because this is the newspaper. We had been trying to get, I mean, we got a decent amount of press, mm-hmm. but...
And what had been your impression of Dushanbe?
Oh, at Dushanbe is nothing like Boulder. So this was a complete, I mean, I couldn't believe, I'm standing there on the streets and thinking, what was he thinking? it's a Persian society. It was, and it is, you know, they weren't practicing Muslims, but they were, you know, it's clearly, it's like 100 miles from Afghanistan or less. I mean, I think you could really, I don't know, it's very close to Afghanistan. And it's actually, it was an artificial boundary. I mean, the Tajiks are, I don't know if they're Pashtun or, but it's some, the tribe overlapped this boundary. The boundary was drawn, I think, in the 1800s when the Russian Empire was being put together, but I'm a little loose on that. Yeah, and it's huge. It's 500,000 people. So it was like, so that's where it was. But it is on the 40th parallel. It is high and dry. It's sunny a lot. And they do have bicycles. And they have conflicts between the bicycles and the cars, which is, they wrote an editorial talking about that. We have this, a slice of life in Dushanbe.
And what sort of people did you meet?
Well, I met a lot of officials. That was the central thing. And then we were taken around and shown, various little sites in the town. And we went on a picnic outside, outside the city up in the hills. And, you know, I met some guy, some really old, completely grizzled guy making tea, on a little burner, and there were lots of, we went to the markets, there were lots of vegetables and fruits. The guide just went crazy because there were melons. I mean, the Soviet Union really was so, it was so obvious that people couldn't get anything, even to an unskilled eye, and when I went there, I had the thought over and over again, this is the country that we're so afraid of. I mean, the weapons were something to be afraid of, but, nothing worked. The elevator didn't work. Things were crooked. I took my slides, the slideshow I gave when I came back was just all the stuff that didn't work. And actually, when we arrived there, I was in Leningrad, and the guy, who was another one of these bored guys, doing this thing, with the computer there, and he walked away, and I just had a curiosity whether it was Cyrillic or Roman letters. And so I hiked myself up. It was a high thing. I hiked myself up to look. It was nothing. It was just gibberish. It was a complete front. There was no computer. He was just horsing with us. It was like, and they would say to you, if you asked for things, they would just say, "Oh, deficitni," which means deficit. It's not available now. Deficitni. So we just started to go around because almost everything was deficitni. But they were very nice, and we met school children. It was kind of a classical, what is a Soviet propaganda tour, with a lot of people dressed up in little outfits, and everybody's extremely polite and nice.
So you saw what they wanted you to see.
Oh, yeah. There was nothing else that you could do. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is, Intourist had an iron grip on this. You were not allowed to wander around. And in fact, we took some pictures once, and the KGB stopped the bus and wanted to take our cameras.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I mean, that this was, it was a highly, highly controlled environment. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this was not, we did get some funny little experiences. Like, we were in Frunze, which is not called that now. It's called, I can't remember the name. We were wandering around, and there was a rock concert, and they found out there were, it was outside, and they found there were Americans in the audience, and they got us all up on the stage. So we would dance with this band, and they were just going nuts that there were Americans. But this is in the Gorbachev. This is right after Gorbachev came in, so there was a little bit of leavening mm-hmm. coming through. So anyway, that's a kind of long story about how we got to the actually having the making the connection. Mm-hmm. So that's 86, the fall of 86, and the mayor came then in May of 87.
I want to stop you for one second.
Sure.
We're going to switch the tapes out right now.
Okay. And then
This is part B, a continuation of the interview with Mary Hay, which is being recorded for the Maria Rogers Oral History Project. The date is January 25th, and my name is Brandon Springer. So when we left off, you were telling us about the mayor coming to Boulder, mm-hmm. the mayor of Dushanbe.
Yes.
So when did that sort of become, when did you start planning that?
Well, I took the trip to the Soviet Union in October of 86, and the mayor came in May. Okay. So we had the planning then took place through that period. It involved just a tremendous amount of effort to have this thing, to pull this off. The mayor came with four other people. And here, this is the packet that we handed out to the media and so forth. So let me see if I can find out who these guys were. Yeah, I mean, part of it, the number of people who helped with this was just enormous. I mean, this is the list I was trying to show earlier of the number of thank yous we had to write. This is just that we had them by alphabetically because there were so many people who at NCAR and at the high school and the Chamber of Commerce that helped. And we had them set up meetings with Tim Worth, who was then our senator, I'm pretty sure, maybe a congressman. But so we planned, and I have the itinerary. Here actually is I guess I don't know if you want to read stuff. Here's the chronology of the project. Well, this isn't, I guess because you're not really writing this up, are you? Let me see here. Yes, Senator Armstrong and Worth. Yeah, so he met both. Senator Armstrong was a Republican, and Tim Worth was a Democrat. Mm-hmm. And we went out of our way to be as explicitly non-political as possible. So we got endorsements from all kinds of people, even Bob Greenlee, who's a member of the city, very conservative member of the city council. He was all in favor mm-hmm. of the sister city arrangement. And this was... we did this very, very carefully and set up the meeting with the mayor also in a way that was because we wanted to get the maximum exposure to have these people exposed to as many Americans as possible and to many Boulderites as possible and to have, our idea was, the papers hadn't been signed, so our idea was this is a greeting. And actually, it was a different mayor from the one I met, who was apparently deposed. I mean, he went away. And if you mention his name, I noticed since then, everybody goes. So the mayor who came was Mayor Ikramov, who was a really kind-hearted man. I found. So we set up meetings with as many different kinds of people as possible. To give them, it was really to help them understand. Here, but see, I don't know if you can see this stuff. Because this, these are the people who came. So, does this work? Maksud Ikramov was the mayor. And then this guy, Pulat, the vice president of the Tajik Academy of Sciences, and Muradali Solikov. He's a member of the house building plant, deputy of the Soviet, of the city Soviet. And then this guy, Farhad Mirzoyev, who is an eighth grader, and he spoke fluent English. They were all really nice people. The kid was wonderful. He was an actor. He was all had appeared in movies and their people, they only sent, I was on a U.S.-Soviet young leaders exchange, and they sent, 7 or 8 people here. They only sent people who were obviously had to be actually party line people. And then that, this was not, people would sometimes accuse us of being naive that, you know, though these people are just, oh, we knew that. We just wanted to have the contact. So, I mean, a wonderful story of for me, what the project is really about is which is this creating understanding. We went to Fairview High School, and the kid and the mayor were on the trip. And there may have been another one. We went to the high school, and it's interesting when you see, it's like when your mother's coming to visit, you recognize your house isn't as clean as you thought it was. That kind of sense, you think like, oh, wait. That going to the high school with all these spiky kids, you know, with their piercings and stuff, it was like, well, you know, it's created the kind of thing, like pride of my country, and saying, well, they're not actually, you know, and they're wearing torn clothes and so forth. And so we're walking around, and I was having this kind of interesting experience of seeing my own country, seeing my own town through their eyes. And we went around and looked at things, and so then we leave, and we're in the van leaving, and the mayor says, how much does it cost to go to school? It's all translated. So he says, but then they're speaking Tajik, so nobody, we had our own translators, but nobody knew Tajik. He said, how much does it cost to go to school? So Farouk says, yeah, how much? And then I said, well, we don't actually, it's a public school. We don't actually pay to go. And then there's a lot of talk. And then he says, well, but somebody pays. I said, well, you know, we pay through taxes. And I said, and we have, you know, property taxes, and that's how. And I described the mill levy and how this worked. And even if you had no children, you had to pay for the schools and like that. And then they got very excited. They started to talk like this, and then they said, so explain taxes. And I said, so I said some more. I said, well, you know, there's a sales tax and these taxes, and so this is like a little part that you pay, and. And, but this is definitely property tax that is really supplying this. And then they went into a flurry of talk. And then the boy had such a bright face. He looks at me and he says, what is property? And that was the moment I thought, oh my God, this is really, we have a lot to learn about them and they about us. But this was a new concept. The idea of taxation was a new concept. And the idea of what I had to describe, that these houses are owned by individuals. And then I remembered when I was in the Soviet Union, it was extremely difficult to keep in my head all the time that no matter where we were, you go into a pharmacy, you go to a restaurant, that they were all government employees. It was very, you know, it's really hard to keep it in your head. You know, you think, oh, the service is no good in here. You think, they're all government employees. So that was, and then at one point I turned to one of the translators, a guy named Rhett Ertl, who was on our board, and he was translating back and forth, and I just thought, are we even talking to each other? I said, how much do you think is actually being transmitted here? And I said, I'm not talking about language. I said, I understand you can get the words right. I said, how much is, he said, like 60%, maybe. So, for us, the trip was, it was extremely exhausting to make all these arrangements and to have the number of things we had to keep track of and so forth. But for our money, it really worked well. And then one of the main events also that was really charming was when, I don't think Linda would mind my saying this, but that at the, when the mayor, Linda Jorgensen was the mayor then by that time, and when she, we had a banquet for like a welcoming banquet, and Mayor Jorgensen and Mary Kromoff danced together. And they were really dancing together. And, you know, I remember looking at Sophia and thinking like, this looks like a a good sister city beginning. Yeah, so anyway, and then they did sign the papers, and we made certain agreements and so forth.
And then, was this the first time, because Boulder Action for Soviet Jewry was involved in this too, was this the first?
They weren't involved, they were involved in...
They were involved in the meeting at one point during Mayor Ikhmov's trip.
Yes, they requested a meeting with the mayor, mm-hmm. and which we, you know, with some consternation agreed to. And, you know, so it's just hard to talk about it, and I'm kind of... Let me just find at least the file that's got all the... Yeah, and I tell you, you know, it looks like I have a separate Boulder Action for Soviet Jewry file. I just created that today for this. I mean, I pulled every time I saw something that looked like it was related to Refuseniks, I just stuck it in this file. So, in which you probably have, because this is BASJ stuff, mm-hmm. you probably have all these articles. And here's a... But I guess there was something I wanted... So our relationship with BASJ was definitely, for my money, was strained.
Why is that?
It was in part... because what it took to pull this off, we were all, I was very, I mean, I had lots of opinions about lots of things that I did not say because of trying to keep this little equanimity along so that people could talk and not go into the same topics. And the fiercest topics, I mean, the issue of Soviet Jews was one of the fiercest topics, for sure. And because it struck me, and lots of us, that it always went down the same channels. And if you opened that topic, it had a certain kind of character, very highly emotional and strained character that ended up with people being ticked off or being at loggerheads or coming to the same. It's like the abortion debate in a way. You know how you know people have a hard time, because it has a certain tendency to go down, you know, and after you've had that discussion lots and lots of times, it doesn't feel very fruitful. It doesn't feel like. And so we were trying because there were letters to the editor that came in that were, you know, utterly furious at us for not including, putting human rights up at the top. And for other reasons, too. I mean, people were just furious at us that we weren't mentioning the war in Afghanistan, which was then their war, not our war. and we weren't bringing up these hot issues, like challenging them. And it wasn't our goal to do that. And it was the same thing that we had been doing for years, trying not to do that in our meetings. And I was talking to Bill Cohen about this, that it's just really a totally different view of what you're doing, that to invite them to come here and to invite them to be our sister city, that what we wanted to do was, we didn't really know them. We wanted to shake their hands, look them in the eyes, welcome them, and learn whatever they wanted to tell us and whatever we wanted to show them, and have that be the substance of what was going on. Not that it was that substantial, but that was the content. And to introduce this issue, it immediately set things. It's an edge. It's like a wedge kind of feel. And the group did arise. I think it was through talking to you, I mean, I guess, really around the possibility of dealing with a Soviet official, that this would create a vehicle. We weren't opposed to there being a bridge, but we didn't want to have anything to do. We didn't want to do that. And we would say, I remember having these conversations saying, you know, this is great, you guys do that, but we can't do, we're not doing that. But the argument came down, of course, that not to do it was a betrayal of one's integrity. I mean, not to mention an elephant in the room, and that we had an obligation to mention human rights, which, you know, it hard pressed me. You know, I mean, I'm not opposed to human rights, and really, I mean, we met with Refuseniks on the trip I took to the Soviet Union, and you know, I mean, I had sympathies, but this was not our issue, and really any polarizing issue was not our issue. So it was with reluctance, really, that we set up the, I mean, we were asked, and actually Murray Richtel and Roxanne Balin and Bill Cohen came to our meeting to present what they were trying to do. I mean, we understood. We just, and really, in talking to Bill lately, in these conversations I've had recently, it's really a question of timing. That it's the idea of saying, "Hi, I'm glad to meet you, and you suck, by the way." We didn't want to do that. We didn't want to do a double whammy on somebody, which had happened in this Young Leaders Exchange thing I was on. These people went out of their way to embarrass these Soviet leaders. Because, and they were party flacks, you know, I mean, I have no, but, you know, it was a little initial thing, trying to get a little dialogue going. But over and over again, we found we would bring them to a situation, and then they would get, like, ambushed and embarrassed. And so we really didn't want that to happen. We really didn't want that to happen. Not that we thought it would destroy the relationship, but that it would compromise what we were trying to do. And I really do think it was at the time, like years, you know, a couple of years later, after you have the thing going, it wouldn't have felt like this. But it did feel like the possibility of derailing everything we were trying to do by creating a big fight, which actually, I went to a Sister Cities International conference after the mayor was there, Bill Cohen was there, and I have a New York Times article that talks about how the whole conference was really about Soviet, people were arguing about Soviet Jews the way the Times article is written, it's as though there are like a bunch of bland people who just want to talk about, you know, superficial things, and then they're the real people who have the real issues. That is not the way the conference was. It's my first doubt of the New York Times. It's the first time I'd ever been at something that they were reporting. I thought, this is not what was going on at this conference. But there were people who disrupted, from this vantage point, disrupted what was being attempted. And I understand totally. I can stand in the shoes of the Boulder Action. I can stand in the shoes and say, and I might have done the same thing. I mean, given the opportunity that now I had an entree to get in and actually sit, you know, get people out who really wanted to get out. But from the vantage point of this trying to keep things, allow little seed, little sprouts to grow and little things to grow, it was hard. It was hard to have that. But it's funny, I talked to Bill about, because his memory of the actual meeting with the mayor, which I felt a little bit like we got ambushed, because we talked to them, we said, we don't want you embarrassing him, we don't want to, you know, this is what we're trying to do, don't do this deal. And it was all agreeable, but when they had the meeting, they did present him then with the prayer shawl and with a prayer book and things for him to take back, which everyone in the room knew he couldn't actually, I mean, this is a dangerous thing for him to, I mean, this is not something, I mean, I don't know what he did with this stuff, but it put the screws on him in a way that I thought was not necessary. But the way Bill tells it is that, you know, that Ekromov really did help, and that it didn't set his teeth on edge, which is fine. So it's maybe my perception of protecting our guest in a way that that made me feel a little bit ambushed by the meeting. I think they weren't quite candid with me, but that's all right. Because it all came out. I mean, the truth is, everything came out well. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is really all's well that ends well, in a way. I mean, not the fact that so many Tajik Jews had to leave Dushanbe or had to leave Tajikistan. It's not that part, but the fact that they were able, the group was able to bring so many Central Asians here, and that the Sister City group was able to have lots of student exchanges, and that we did create a definite avenue for lots of different exchanges to go on. So
did you continue to have interactions with Boulder Action for Soviet Jewry after that? That was the one time.
Yeah, we were really doing something different.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know that there were, you know, that I know Roxanne and, I mean, people went on the trips, mm-hmm. you know, so the vehicle, now the thing was open once, you know, I think there was a sister city trip almost immediately. Yeah. Yeah, I was talking to Bill Cohen just the other day, and I said to him that this whole Soviet Sister City project really changed my life, and he said it changed my life completely. It really did. And I said, yeah. I said I think it brought out my best talents. I mean, my best ability to, you know, inventiveness and do this various, you know, to get this thing going. And he said, I think it brought out my best talents too. The Boulder Action for Soviet Jewry did. Mm-hmm. That he was able to use his teaching experience, his ability to persuade, his, you know, I mean, you could ask him what all those things were. But it was really wonderful to come down, because there were, you know, there were some time there that was really not, it was hard. It was trying to, you know, because it felt, you know, and also I think there was some kind of sense of our being, you know, there was a way to accuse us of being anti-Semitic. Not that I remember anybody doing that, but a feeling pressed in a funny way, like, you know, of saying no, but, you know, not wanting to say no. You know, that it wasn't no, it was like, no. Not now, or not here, or something. And so that discomfort was, I really wasn't crazy about that. But mm-hmm. I clerked for a judge in the district court. I also, Murray Richtel was a judge, and we became good friends, you know, through that. In a kind of, we had to recover. So let's see, I was 92, that we had to kind of tiptoe around a little bit to get back to, you know, a good relationship, because, yeah, I think that we were so persuaded of our point of view, and they were so persuaded of their point of view, and I can remember talking to Murray Richtel as I was sweeping the porch. I could just see this, and he kept saying, "Well, yeah, but Mary, there's this and this, and you have to do this and this and that," and finally I just said, "I just disagree with you. And that's just the truth of it." And he was like, well, because I don't think he was used to people. I mean, he was very persuasive, but in that context, I wasn't buying. Mm-hmm. So, but I think it was, and I know that there were good people had good experiences going to the city, and all of this stuff is rough. You know, I mean, all of this had a certain edge on it, because the Soviets were forced to say things that, you know, they had to say these things about, they had to give the party line. Mm-hmm. I have the guide who took us on that 3-week trip in 1986 became a good friend of mine. I've gone to see her in St. Petersburg a couple of times. She's been Boulder 4 or 5 times, and she was a party member, and, you know, she was a trusted interest guide, and you know, I asked her later, you know, what was really going on. I mean, what, you know, and she said, you know, we all got used to that part. She said the hardest part was when we discovered that these guys, you know, were living so much better than we were. You know, that there was these huge differences in the apparatchiks, the people who were in power.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that there really was a two-tiered system, and the betrayal that people felt about that, and the kind of cynicism that developed out of that was intense.
Mm-hmm. So you had mentioned that there was a trip in which two BASJ members had mm-hmm. gone along with the Sister City group to Dushanbe.
Yeah.
And had you been on that trip?
No.
And what were your memories of that trip and sort of reports from that trip? And
you know, I honestly don't. My situation was, I did this from 83 to 87, and by the time it came to the end, I was really kind of used up. And I mean, I stayed on the board a while after that, but I ceased being the president the moment that the mayors got on the plane.
Mm-hmm.
And that was so, and others took over. Sophia Stoller stayed in and would have really, you know, more to say about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Mary Axe was on that trip as well. I don't actually know, so I'm not the... I don't know. I know there were further encounters because I think Rebecca Bradley, was she?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I can't recall exactly.
Mm-hmm. And you had mentioned that you had met with Refuseniks on a trip.
Mm-hmm.
What was that experience like?
God, it was so long ago. I don't really remember being in an apartment and the kinds of complaints, but it was, I guess my experience of meeting, this was in Moscow, and was set up by, I just don't remember actually, I couldn't have been set up by the guide. I don't know how we even got there. But my experience was of the complaints people had, this particular couple was saying seemed like complaints. They seemed to actually be in better shape than a bunch of people, and they didn't seem to be, I don't remember being, overwhelmed by their difficult situation. I mean, it was just my impression that they were doing pretty well, they were eating well, they had nice stuff. I don't know. But I don't mean at all to diminish this whole situation. The Soviet Union was so radically anti-Semitic, as so many, so much of that part of the world is, and to this day, I mean, even in Eastern Europe and stuff. Yeah, so, and that the country, this was a terrible system.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just a horrible system that really forced people not to trust each other. And you could never tell who was next to you and destroyed. I mean, this is when I used to have to say sympathetic things about the Soviet Union because I was just cast in this role of saying, trying to say, well, maybe it's not that bad. We need to find out more things and, stuff like that. And I was constantly getting in trouble. I mean, the Rocky Mountain News wrote an editorial calling me an idiot. And so that was okay. But a DU professor told me, you can never say, if you say anything about the Soviet Union, there's an unspoken however. And so you can say, they have, lots of, great schools, but however, not everybody can go. And so there's this, so you could choose one side or the other. And if you're talking to reporters, they always chose whatever side they liked. So I spoke at the Air Force Academy and I spoke in Colorado Springs, they just like lurked in the bushes till they found something that they could nail me with, making me, a fool or a useful idiot. That was one of we were called that on the radio. But yeah, you got kind of used to it in a way. So, yeah.
Well, so you stopped being the president after the mayor came. Do you want to sort of relate the history of what happened after that in your life and with your relationship with the Sister City group?
Well, following that, there were just lots and lots of exchanges, and then this the acceptance of the tea house, which happened really on the mayor's visit. That tea house first emerged as an idea. So that's in 87, and they spent 2 years making the thing, and then they sent it over in pieces. I don't know if you know about it.
No.
It's an amazing. It's all hand carved. There were no power tools used to make it. Have you been there?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It and it came with like a little AA prime. It was all Cyrillic though. It was like a puzzle that they put together and sent. They sent workers, but this is just enormous effort that went on here. I was on a task force for trying to place the thing at some point. I mean, it just went on and on. And then actually in 89, it must have been when I was in law school, I got the idea that I have a connection with somebody in FedEx that to try to get FedEx to bring the thing over here because we couldn't, it cost 50 grand or something to get it here. Yeah. And so it was like, and I almost came very close to getting a meeting in New York with to try to sell this, because they had that campaign that we'll ship anything anywhere. It felt like a tea house, but it was too politically, it had a potential downside. So they didn't want to do it. Yeah, so, yeah, the, I mean, you could really talk to others more about that. I have really not been involved in the group in a serious way for a long time.
So then you went to law school.
I did.
And then now you're an artist.
I'm a painter, yes.
And how did that come about?
This is kind of off topic.
Well, it's just sort of maybe to conclude.
Oh, okay. Well, I went to interview for a job at Colorado Lawyers for the Arts. And so there I was at the Art Students League in Denver, and that's where the interview took place. And I was there in my suit with my briefcase and so forth, and walked in, and it's an old schoolhouse. It's as old as this house, like over 100 years old. And I went into the interview, and the woman was very casual and nice, and I was having trouble finding my location in the law. So I thought, this is going to work. This will be all right. I just have to deal with artists and no divorces. And it's like... and she said, "Oh, just, you know, why don't you wait here a minute? I'm going to go get you. I didn't bring your resume." And so I'm sitting in it was a room with all these easels in it. It smelled like oil paint, and I had never heard of the place before. And I'm sitting there, and I painted when I was a kid, and as I was sitting there, I had it was kind of just like a little epiphany, but the smell of the paint was really what did it. That when she came back in, I was, you know, kind of like a little, you know, had like, it was like a little overwhelmed. And I said, "What is this place?" And she said, "Yeah, you can come and, you know, study here, and people just come month to month." And I mean, it was a real moment in my life. It was like being pulled out to sea in a way. And so she was very casual and said, "Oh, I think you got the, you know, I think it's okay. You're going to get the job. It's right." You know, and it turned out I didn't get the job. And when I didn't, there was some friend, I guess, friend of the board, chairman of the board, who took out the job. But in the interim, I had decided, before I heard I hadn't gotten the job, I thought, it was just a part-time job. I thought, this is great. I can do law in the afternoon, and I can come sign up for and do paint in the morning. You know, and the only artist, Colorado artist I knew was teaching there, who I really loved his work. And I thought, I can actually study with this guy. And so I developed a whole, like I was going to escape from the burden of actually having to be a real lawyer, which I was not equipped to do, and also get this painting thing. So after I didn't get the job, I just completely had an unbelievable crisis. I was so upset, like absurdly upset. And I woke up one morning and I thought, it's not the job, it's the art. And so I thought, well, what the heck, I'm still unemployed. I'll just go down and start taking classes. It was only $50 a month to study. And so I started driving to Denver and just had this just marvelous period of just being absolutely on fire about art. Was really tremendous. Yeah, so
well, that's that all was I that. That's all I have. Is there anything you would like to touch on again, or any story that you'd like to relate in closing?
Oh, I don't know. I have a million stories, but I think you probably heard enough from me. Particularly, so not that much of it is associated with the Boulder Action for Soviet Jewry. Although I was encouraged when Bill said that the Sister City Project changed his life. I thought that was very... That was touching to me. So glad to have done whatever it was that allowed that to happen. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Okay. Yeah. You guys are terrific.